Good morning, everybody, and welcome to worship. Have a few announcements. Coming up in September, our guest minister will be Reverend Elizabeth Perry. We need to send our prayers out for all who are sick and healing, those who are grieving and hurting, particularly those who experienced Hurricane Laura last week. Quite a bit of devastation. Down in Lake Charles, Louisiana, and many places. And I'm happy to see Betty Sheets is here with us, but we will pray for her recovery from a broken shoulder. And thankfully she's home, and I hope resting comfortably. So prayers for healing, Betty. And again, another call just for help wanted. Even though we're not coming together in person, we are coming together virtually, and there's still work to be done for our church. So please, if you are interested and have some time to be of service on a board or a committee, please reach out and ask to join. You can let Cindy Herendine know, and her contact is there on the screen. Zoom Bible studies on a summer break. While we're still in summer, a few more days, and it will resume in September. And the care committee is listed also there for you. Please reach out if you have some hands that need to help our congregants. It would be appreciated. Silent prayer and meditation is still taking place. Plenty to pray for these days. So please join if you're able on Tuesday from 7 to 7:30. And great news, Sunday school is going to be starting soon, virtually, so things are starting to come back online as we're used to, but we're looking for some angels to be present during the Sunday school sessions to be of assistance to the classroom teacher. I think you're going to reach out to Rachel. Boone, thank you. Tom's helping me beside me. Reach out to Rachel Boone if you can be of service as an angel. And one more quick announcement that I forgot to mention earlier is that the pastoral search team has finalized the profile with Reverend Marcia, and it, I believe, has been posted online. There's a little bit of a glitch that the summary page still is listing it as a designated pastor position, which it is not. We'll be looking for a settled pastor. So hopefully that will be updated this week, and we will start getting some profiles in, and the work of the committee will continue. So please keep us in your prayers as well. And now I would like to introduce Reverend Glen, Dr. Glen Misick. Sorry, I left that out before. But really at this point needs no introduction. We've been blessed to have him as our guest minister this entire month of July, recently, but with us during this whole interim time.
August.
Thank you. I want to go back, I guess, but August. So Reverend Misick, thank you so much for joining us being our spiritual leader.
So good morning, everyone, and welcome once again to this nice fall day. Wow, it's what a big change, but we give thanks to God anyway. So as we prepare to worship God, let us open with prayer. Eternal God, you are the God of our weary years, the God of our silent tears. You are the God who has brought us thus far on our way. We worship you this day. We praise you. As we attempt to enter into your presence now, we invoke the presence of your Holy Spirit into this place, that our worship may be in spirit and in truth. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen.
Please join in the call to worship. But I, through the abundance of your steadfast love, will enter your house. I will bow down toward your holy temple in awe of you.
Lead me, O Lord, in your righteousness because of my enemies. Make your way straight before me.
Good morning, everyone. And let us all join together singing, O for a thousand tongues to sing.
Do we enter God's presence with praise and thanksgiving, but we also enter with confession. We confess our sins to Almighty God, the sins that we have done and we don't even know that we did, that little smile we forgot to give, that little thank you to God for waking us up this morning. So let us confess our sins, prayer of confession. Let us read together. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips tremble to name, what our hearts can no longer bear, and what has become for us a consuming fire of judgment. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open to us a future in which we can be changed, and grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the light of the world. Amen. Assurance of pardon, Almighty God, who does freely pardon all who repent and turn to him, now fulfill in every contrite heart the promise of redeeming grace. forgiving all our sins and cleansing us from an evil conscience through the perfect sacrifice of Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. My friends, the peace of Christ be with you. Cindy, unmute yourself. Yeah.
Okay. I'm here. So our reading from the Old Testament comes from 2 Chronicles, chapter 7. Chapter 7, verses 11 through 16. Thus Solomon finished the house of the Lord and the king's house. All that Solomon had planned to do in the house of the Lord and in his own house, he successfully accomplished. Then the Lord appeared to Solomon in the night and said to him, I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a house of sacrifice. When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command the locusts to devour the land, or send pestilence among my people, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves, pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayer that is made in this place. For now I have chosen and consecrated this house so that my name may be there forever. My eyes and my heart will be there for all time.
Okay, and this psalm this morning, this is something new I'm trying. I composed a responsorial psalm, which hopefully you can sing back to me at home. Please stay muted, but you can sing along. I think you'll figure this out as we go. So here we go.
Children of the Lord.
The gospel reading comes to us from Philippians chapter 1, verse 27 through 30. Only live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent and hear about you, I will know that you are standing firm in one spirit, striving side by side with one mind for the faith of the gospel, and are in no way intimidated by your opponents. For them, this is evidence of their destruction, but of your salvation. And this is God's doing, for he has graciously granted you the privilege, not only of believing in Christ, but of suffering for him as well, since you are having the same struggle that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. So I want to preach a sermon this morning. I'm trying to figure out whether I've preached it at used it with you. I get to preach at different churches, so sometimes I don't know where I have, but I thought it would be appropriate. We have two important scriptures, one from Chronicles, First Chronicles chapter 7. Everybody have heard that, I'm sure, that particular verse 7:14, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray. I can actually do a sermon on that whole passage there, but I am going to stick with the Philippians chapter. And for those of you scholars, I know we do have a scholar in our church, you know that is not, Philippians is not a gospel. It's an epistle. So we'll get that right. Only just four gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But the rest of the, the book of Acts. And by the way, I hope you guys are doing your reading of the Bible, right? Don't wait until you get deep into trouble. Read the word is there. It's powerful. I gotten through the book of Acts. I'm almost finished with Romans now. I started on Genesis a couple of years ago, so I'm reading all the way through the Bible. It's powerful, believe me, very powerful. My sermon topic is entitled this morning, What Are They Saying About the Church? Now, what are we saying? What are they, the people on the outside, saying about the church? My text is taken from that 27th verse of Philippians chapter 1 and 27a. Whatever happens, Paul says, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. May we pray. Lord, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts will be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Let all of God's people say, amen. Yes, they're talking about a lot of things in our world today, especially the global impact of this coronavirus, with thousands of people, if not millions of people, who have died or who will die. And they're also talking about the crippling economies, not just here in the United States. Some of us, we're not sure whether we're going to get a stimulus check or we're going to get some help. We don't know whether our jobs will open back up again. There's the whole controversy with opening up our schools. And whereas in the beginning of this, back in April, I think it was, we thought that this virus would only affect older people. We're finding now that it's affecting young people. And some parents are saying, why should I let my child go to school? As we know, a lot of grandparents pick up children from school. I'm looking at a school right across from us here. And every afternoon when it was open, I would see more grandparents or older people picking up the children. But the children can also spread the virus. But there are children that are dying too from this virus. So people are afraid. They are nervous. They are beyond nervous. I mean, we're living in this whole thing is just so complicated. We don't know which way it's going, when it's going to stop. But I admonish you to wear your mask, be careful, take care of yourself, get some rest, but also get some exercise. I got up this morning. I didn't feel like doing it, but I did me some exercise. Yesterday I went and took a walk, get a little fresh air too. So take care of yourself. So they're talking about that pandemic, the pandemic of the coronavirus, but there's another pandemic that we're also talking about, unfortunately. It is the pandemic of systemic racism, and especially in our country. I was just shocked the last week or so to hear of the death of Jacob Blake in Kenosha, Wisconsin. Young man, I'm sorry, it wasn't a death, it was the shooting. 7 bullets in his back, and he's now paralyzed in the hospital. Why? I thought that with the death of George Floyd, Breonna, and others, that we would have gotten it. And God is trying to speak to us. God uses these plagues and other times when we shuts us down so that we can listen to him. And he's saying he's not pleased with this race issue in the United States. He's really, really not pleased. And I thought many of us talking that we thought that with George Floyd and the knee on his neck and all of that and the worldwide reaction to it, that we would have gotten it. But here we go again with policemen shooting this young man. And then the other young man coming up, another white young man coming up with a gun and shooting 2 other protesters who happen to be white, by the way. I think he killed 2 of them. What is going on, my friends? What is going on? We are really in the ICU unit of our lives, and we need to get it right. And I believe from my study of history that God stays with us until we get it right. We cannot just brush this under the rug and say, oh, you know, sing kumbaya and say, oh, this can we all just get along? We can get along, but it has to do with our understanding of systemic racism, how it works, how certain people are privileged and others are not, how people judge you by the color of your skin and not the content of your character, as Dr. King said. And then to make that a little more hard on us, particularly as African Americans, people of color, just Friday night, I was sitting here, my wife and I were watching television, and she said to me, she said, oh, you know, you remember the guy who starred in Black Panther? I said, yeah. She said, he just died. Chadwick Boseman. Oh my God. And I pick up my phone and I called my cousin because we just had a virtual family reunion the other day. And my cousin, who she is a professor at Howard University, she teaches in the fine arts department. And I called her and I said, and before I can get, she said, I know why you're calling. Because I knew that she knew Chadwick Boseman, and that he was a graduate of Howard University. Last year he gave the commencement speech. And so I said to her, and she was crying, and she said, because she was working with him on reforming the fine arts department at Howard University in Washington. And I prayed with her. And the impact of this, some of you may not understand, but for many of our young Black and brown people, this young man epitomized the type of role model. When I was growing up, my role model was Sir Sidney Poitier, who's from the Bahamas. His mother is from the Turks and Caicos Islands. And he also pops up as a distant cousin of mine. So I love to go, you know, I would love to go to the movies and watch Sidney, and I would walk out acting like him. Everybody needs a role model. Chadwick was a role model to many young people. Wakanda, you see many people walking around now, black and white, or everybody with the beard that came from that movie. If you haven't watched the movie, don't let Black Panther throw you off. It's not about the Black Panthers. It's a wonderful movie. And it's shrouded in mystery, but it's about a kingdom in Africa. And he became the first Black Marvel character. But beyond that, And here is something that's pertinent for Church in the Gardens, okay? Chadwick played several icons in movies. And I believe it was the first one that he played was, guess who? Jackie Robinson. And he died on Friday, the day when they were celebrating Jackie Robinson, you know, overcoming the color barrier in baseball. And how does this relate to Church in the Gardens? Well, the person who helped him most was Branch Rickey, a member of your church. Isn't that wonderful? It's amazing. Oh God, we can show you some more Branch Rickeys in today's world. I support LeBron James and others who in the NBA, they just stopped that whole playoff and say, we need to be responsible. We're getting rich and yet, you know, we're just exceptional. We have to be exceptional. And there are other young Black men more in prison than are in college. So my friends are talking about a lot of things in our world. And so we need to pay attention. Chadwick Boseman, you may know too, and you may want to go and check out some of his movies. Just an excellent actor. He played Thurgood Marshall. He played the singer James Brown. And, you know, Thurgood Marshall was the first Black Supreme Court judge. You know, but the character of that he played in Black Panther, and we go around, we say Wakanda. That's not the name, but it's a wonderful movie. And it brought so much pride to those of us who are often looked down upon and who are told that we cannot be somebody. And he went around, he did a whole lot of stuff. He did a lot of stuff here in Harlem helping young people. So we pray, let us continue to pray for his family. It is said that he had cancer for 4 years and he kept it silent. He did those movies even through some of that cancer. What a strong young man, 43 years old. My friend, somehow we have a sinister way of wanting to sweep under the rug what has and continues to happen to people of African descent. Can't we, and we say again, can't we just forget about this? Can't we just move on? No, we can't. We can't move on. If I am not free, neither are you. I believe as far as this issue of race is concerned, God wants us to linger a while longer in the wilderness, which I've been talking about. He wants us to stay in the wilderness because in the wilderness is when he can get our attention. In the wilderness is when we can do reflection and when we can think and we come up with a vision. Church in the Garden, you need to come up with a strong vision. You can't go back to being what you were. You know, God said, the Bible says, behold, I am doing a new thing. And we hear from the book of Chronicles, after Solomon built this wonderful temple, which is still in Jerusalem to this day, you got all different religions fighting over it. You know, God says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, seek my face and pray, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and heal their land. Who's God's people? As followers of Jesus, we are also God's people today. The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said this about the church more than 50 years ago. These words are still true. And I quote, he says, it must be the guide and the critic of the state and never its tool. If the church does not recapture its prophetic zeal, it will become an irrelevant social club without moral or spiritual authority. Ouch, that hurts. That hurts, unquote. So they're talking about a lot of things in our world, but the issue is, what are they saying about the church, the body of Jesus Christ, the ecclesia in Greek? Our second lesson from Philippians, and that we learn that the Apostle Paul was concerned about the church at Philippi. Which was caught up in the Roman sphere of influence. There existed in Rome a climate of moral and spiritual decadence. The Philippians, instead of wanting to be a part of the kingdom of God, sought to be a part of the empire of Rome. What is our church doing today? Do we want to just be a part of the, I know we have the elections coming up. I'm not going to comment on it, but you make sure that you go out and vote. The philosophical question of that day and today was and is, what is truth? Are there any absolutes in life? Rome was a crumbling culture. There was a breakdown in its ethical and moral standards. But it was into this crumbling culture that God decided to set up his church, a church which dared to seek out to become not a part of the problem, but a solution to the problem. Again, what are they saying about the church in this crumbling culture? When the philosopher asked the question, what is truth? It was this little church at Philippi, which dared to say, you shall know the truth. And as Jesus said, and the truth shall set you free. This little church, like Church in the Gardens, stood tall in the midst of the chaos and let the world know unapologetically that God is still on the throne. Jesus is still the answer, and the Holy Spirit is still available as a comforter, as a healer, as a psychologist, as a doctor, as a lawyer, and most importantly, as a redeemer and friend. Paul was saying, they, the world, won't and sometimes will refuse to believe you, but stand tall anyway as God's defense in the world. Don't let them break your spirit. Paul is saying, I am here in prison in Rome, but I am going to be listening to hear what they are saying about your witness in the saving grace of the saving to the saving grace and transformative power of Jesus Christ. There are a lot of lonely people out there. They say the suicide rate is just going up so high right now, especially among our young people. There are a lot of lonely people, frustrated people out there in our world. Many have even given up on life. People are angry and just cannot take the precious anymore. They are going to be watching us. And in the years to come, Paul is saying, you must be mindful of what they say about the church, the body of Christ. Let me leave three things with you, which I believe Paul was trying to say to this church at Philippi and is saying to us. I believe the first thing he's saying is, do not let them say you had no courage. And so many of our churches are sitting back and, as Dr. King said, like little social clubs, you know, we stay to ourselves, we're comfortable with ourselves. But God didn't call us to do that. God called us, Jesus says in Matthew 28, the Great Commission said, go into the world and make disciples, reproduce yourselves, bring others into the kingdom. It's as if you found $1 billion and you want to keep it to yourself. It's as if you found a huge mansion and you want to just, you know, I'm not letting anybody into my house. You know, throw a big party, Jesus is saying. The first thing Jesus did when he went out to his ministry, he went to a party. He threw a party. He constantly went around and was healing people and telling them about the kingdom of God, which is available to us. My friends, the scripture says God did not give us a spirit of fear. In Psalm 46, the writer says, God is our refuge and strength, therefore a very present help in trouble, therefore we will not fear. 1 John 4 says, greater is he that is within you than he that is within the world. And again, Ephesians 6 says, put on the whole armor of God. The problem, my friends, with many of our churches today is that we, like the lion and the Wizard of Oz, have lost our courage. Indeed, our armor and sometimes even our faith in God. We've lost faith in God. We've lost faith, as James Weldon Johnson put it, in the God of our weary years, the God of our silent tears, the God who has brought us thus far on our way. I believe we suffer from what I call Swiss. S-W-I-S. I just made this up last night, okay? From a spirit, so if anybody uses it, just give me some credit for it, okay? No plagiarism here. Okay, and I call it, we suffer from a spiritual weakened immune system. A spiritual weakened immune system. And so we settle for what one theologian, one of my favorite theologians, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, calls cheap grace. He says, cheap grace is the grace we bestow on ourselves. Cheap grace is the preaching of forgiveness without requiring repentance. Cheap grace is baptism without church discipline. Cheap grace is communion without confession. Cheap grace is grace without discipleship, grace without the cross, grace without Jesus Christ living and incarnate. In the 14th verse of this chapter in Philippians, Paul says, and because of my chains, he was in chains in prison in Rome. He says, and because of my chains, most of the brothers and sisters have become confident in the Lord and dare all the more to proclaim the gospel without fear. So the text is, whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. So don't let them say you have no courage. Second point, don't let them say there was no unity in the body of Christ. So what if you like to sing anthems? And I grew up in a church that sang anthems, right? I knew nothing about gospel music and all that. That's why my album that I wrote was really basically used music that people like Earth, Wind, and Fire and all that. I just used the music. There's nothing wrong with music, okay? It's the lyrics and the music, if you use the right lyrics. So I rewrote the lyrics to a lot of the songs and I began to bring it up. It's more urban contemporary. Some of you may not care for it that much, but you know, the young people do it. I did it back in the 1980s. But so what if you like anthems, you like hymns, and others like contemporary worship music? What does it matter? What does matter is that, you know, you need to make sure that when you sing or when you worship, that you're worshiping God. That you're not just worshiping some genre of music that's been around for hundreds of years and beautiful music. I love Handel's Messiah. I love John and Charles Wesley's hymns and great hymns. Sing them all the time. I play them on my keyboard over here all the time. And, you know, my mother, you know, would witness to us. She'd always be singing hymns. Whenever we did something wrong and she got sick and tired of us, she'd go shut up in her room and start singing some hymns. And the louder we get, the louder she'd get. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory. Mama, you're singing too loud. You know, y'all shut up. I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to God. You know, so we need to really develop that. We need to develop a sense of unity in the church. You know, so what if you like to say amen and somebody likes to be quiet? You know, some people say amen with just their face. You know, I my wife and I, we do workshops. We always say, if you don't want to say an amen, I think you've heard this before, you know, at least try to look an amen. You know, the Bible says, enter his presence with thanksgiving. Enter his courts with what? Praise. Learn how to praise God. You come to church. When you go to church, by the way, you're not coming to church. You are the church, okay? So you just come into a place to worship God. Here we are now in the wilderness, right? And God throws us. We ought to be thankful to God. Some people are complaining. We ought to be thankful that God has even allowed us this Zoom. We didn't have this 20 years ago. We would have been somewhere trying to get on the telephone, trying to hear, you know, somebody preach or whatever. But here it is. We can look at each other. So the Bible says, in all things give thanks. Let there be unity in the church. It said of the early Christians, and it said that, you know, the reason people were attracted to them is because of how they love one another, how they cared for them. When you look in that second chapter of the book of Acts, after the Pentecost, after the Holy Spirit came, and towards the end, it says that they all put together their resources and they begin to help each other. How many people are out there that are hurting right now? I just saw in the news this morning, so many homeless people that are hungry. But I've also seen some good people that have been feeding chefs who have no more restaurants left now. And they're making good food and taking it. One guy said, I'll deliver the food to you. There are people who need us. So we need to come together in unity. A number of our mainline churches are on the decline. We know that. And Corona is not helping. I believe that this decline has to do with a lack of focus and purpose. Who are we? The Bible says where there is no vision or mission, the people perish. It seems to me that we need another reformation. We need another Isuzu movement. Those of you who don't know what the Isuzu movement is, but a little over 100 years ago, it was the revival of the Pentecostal church. We need a new Pentecost experience. Indeed, we need a revival in our churches. I love that old hymn that says, revive us again, fill each heart with thy love. Let each soul be rekindled with fire from above. Hallelujah, thine the glory. By the way, hallelujah means praise God in Hebrew. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory, revive us again. Paul says, whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of church. Then thirdly, so the first, we need courage, we need unity in the church in order for the church to be effective in this new age, in this new world. And then thirdly, I believe Paul is saying, do not let them say there was no love in the church. Don't let them say there was no love in the church. And by love, I would want to use the Greek word agape. Agape love, you know, this philios, which some people, even non-Christians, do even better than us sometimes. But agape love means divine love, that love that will not let us go, no matter how far we run from God. God's grace is sufficient. Paul says, "My grace is sufficient." God said to Paul. So, in 1 John chapter 4, verse 18, you notice I'm quoting a lot of scriptures. That's what you need to really get into the scriptures and you'll find the answers. First John 4:18 says, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. And then in verse 20 says, if a man says, or a woman, that I love God and hate his brother, he or she is a liar. For if he or she loves not his brother or sister, whom he sees every day, how can he love God whom he has not seen? Then John 15, we hear Jesus speaking. The Gospel of John 15, verse 12 says, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he or she lay down his or her life for his friends. Some of the historians observing the behavior, as I said, of the early churches says, oh, how they love one another. I love that hymn. Again, I just love hymns and songs that says, and they'll know we are Christians, not by how dignified we are, not by how sophisticated we are, not by how much money, not by how pretty our building is. They'll know we're Christians by our love. Jesus once asked Peter a very poignant existential question. Peter, do you love me? And Peter says, oh, Lord, you know I love you. And the thing I like about God is God comes back at us 1, 2, 3 times at least. And Jesus came back and said, Peter, do you love me? And Peter, he got Peter's attention there. He said, Lord, you know I love you. And then the third time he asked him, Peter, do you love me? I believe the first he was saying filios, you know, do you, like Philadelphia, brotherly, sisterly love. And then in the end, Jesus says, Peter, do you love me? Do you agape me? Peter had to think. Sometimes we need you to stop and think when God speaks to us. Do you really love me? He said, if you really love me, then go feed my sheep. I have sheep that are not of this fold. Go and reach out to them. Go feed my flock. And God is calling us to do that this morning. So the text again, whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel. As I come to a close, the world is watching us. But most importantly, God is watching us. God is watching to see if we get it right. and about being the true church of Christ. Our hymn of invitation, as what Sonny will sing in a second, challenges us. It's an affirmation, but it's also a challenge. Lord, I want to be a Christian. Where? In my heart. Heart means spirit, not just my head, not just doing good deeds for people. Anybody can do that. Lord, I want to be a Christian in my spirit, the imago Dei, the image of God. And Lord, I want to be more loving. Lord, I want to be like Jesus. That's the essence of what God is calling us to be and to do. So what are they saying about the church? I hope that in the months and years to come, that Church in the Garden is going to exemplify and throw out some more Branch Rickeys, right? Throw out some more people that will impact the world like you've never done it before with the powerful gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This is my prayer. May God bless you. May God continue to help you. Amen.
And now let us sing, Lord, I Want to Be a Christian.
Thank you, Sonny. Thank you. Let us pray. Eternal and most loving God, We bless you this day. We praise you. We thank you that you are still on the throne. We thank you that even though the winds blow and the storms come, the virus has come, that you are still God all by yourself. And you are there for us. We thank you for sending your son, Jesus, into the world to become one of us, to identify with our humanity, and to walk with us, to understand our griefs and our sorrows and our pain. Lord, we thank you that you, not only that even when he left here, you sent the Holy Spirit to be with us, to be our comforter and our counselor and our guide. And if ever we need you, we do need you now. We are in the midst of these viruses, Lord, these pandemics. And you have said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and heal their land. We need healing, Lord. We are trying to humble ourselves. We're praying to you this morning, asking that you bring healing to those who are suffering from this virus, from these viruses right now. Bring healing to the bodies, bring healing to the minds and to the hearts. Help us to be more like Jesus in our hearts, in our heads, in our bodies, in our actions. We pray, oh God, for a church in the gardens, that you continue to guide them. Help them to wait upon you, knowing that though they who wait upon you shall renew their strength, they shall mount up with wings like eagles, shall run and not grow weary, walk and not faint. We pray that you continue to bless and guide them, guide the leadership. As they seek an under shepherd for the church, Lord, help them to pick that person that will exemplify what your church really is to the world. We pray for all churches. We pray that you would bless and guide them. Help us to be that light upon the hill, Lord. Help us to be the salt of the earth. We lift up each one on our sick and shut-in list at the church. We pray that you bless and heal them. We thank you, O God, for Betty and for her successful operation. Continue to heal her body. And Lord, we lift up those victims of Hurricane Laura this week. We pray that you would comfort those who've lost loved ones, comfort those who've lost property, restore to them, Lord, even more than what they have. Be with those who are homeless. We pray for our city. We pray for our state. We pray for our nation, Lord, particularly in this turmoil now, Lord. We pray that you bring healing, Lord, to the racial divide in this country. Come, Jesus, we need you. We really need you. We're tired. We're sick and tired of being sick and tired. So we ask that you send your Holy Spirit and heal us, Lord. We pray for our president, guide him in your direction. We pray for all those who are running for office, Lord. Help them, Lord, to not do business as usual, but to do a new thing. We pray for our world, other countries that the people are suffering. We pray that you be with them and touch them. We lift up our students that are going back to school, Lord. We pray that you would bless and protect them. We bless you this morning. We give you praise, honor, and glory. And now, Lord, we ask that you hear the request of your people that are present here this morning.
Be with my niece, Joni, who evacuated Shreveport, Louisiana. And I praise God for her safety, and I'm glad that she was able to come back to her home that was only partially hurt, threatened by a giant oak tree right next to her roof.
Pray for Rosa.
Pray for my nephews who are waiting to hear. They are sick, but they're not sure what kind of sick yet. So pray that it's not serious. And pray for the continued health of my parents who are moving to Queens next week. I give praise and thanks that they're doing well.
Lord, Lord, we thank you for your word, which says that if we ask anything in your name, you will grant it to us. And so we believe that you've heard the prayers, the silent, the spoken prayers of your people this morning. And so we know that you have. So without any further ado, we thank you for what you're doing now, and what you're going to do. So we bless you and we give you the glory, the honor, and the praise in the name of Jesus, the one who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. My friends, this is God has blessed us with his word, and God, and Micah says, bring your tithes and offerings into the storehouse of the Lord, and see if I will not open up the windows of heaven. I think if God opened up the doors sometimes for some of us, we couldn't stand it, right? But God said, I will open up the windows of heaven for such a blessing that you will not have room enough to maintain it. God has been good to us. God has blessed us. Why don't we be good to God? And one way we can do that is by giving of our tithes and offerings to this church, which we have taken out membership. It is our responsibility of stewardship to be good stewards of God's money. And so give now, as Cindy explains to you, how you can give for the work of the ministry of this church.
I hope everybody's got it by now that you can go to PayPal and pay through that to give your offering. You can set up automatic payment through your bank to be given to the church on a regular basis. And you can write a check and mail it in. And I think everybody's got it. Thank you. Let us pray. Merciful and forgiving God, the tithes and gifts we offer to you this morning are but a small portion of the blessings we have received. The Gospels remind us that Jesus instructed us to deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow. And yet we deny ourselves little. See the smallest of crosses as too great a burden, and follow only from a safe distance. In doing so, we cut ourselves off from deeper experiences of discipleship. Forgive us and renew our strength and discipline to walk this road with our Savior. In his holy name we pray. Amen.
And now let us sing Go to the World.
Christ renews life's worth, baptizing as the sign of our own birth. Alleluia. Go to the world, go struggle, bless and pray. The nights of tears give way to joyful day.
Thank you, Sonny. Thank you, Cindy. Thank you, Rama. I will hopefully be back in November, so I get to get a little break. and as you, I believe the song was sort of the benediction, but let me give you this benediction from Romans chapter 8, verses 38 through 39. Says, for I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height or depth nor depth, nor anything else in all, in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. My friends, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace as you go back into the world to be the church of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Sonny. Thank you for that wonderful Dale Noble Christians by our love. Now let us greet each other. It's time for coffee hour. Grab your coffee. Start chatting with each other. Rama is going to open you guys up, and good to see you. And This beautiful.
Thank you, Reverend. Nice. Thank you, Sunny. Thank you. Wonderful as always.
We will miss you, Reverend Misick. Be well.
Miss you guys too.
Jennifer,
thank you.
Be well.
Thank you, Reverend.
Thank you.
Yes, it was very nice. Take care, Reverend.
Thank you. God bless.
Sunny, it was really great music. Thank you so much.
Yes, beautiful. You're welcome. Thank you.
Always.
Yes, were you singing
beautiful
at,
service.
Along at home, I hope. Sometimes yes. I can see your lips moving, so I
see. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You're lucky that's all you hear from me.
It's called lip singing, right?
The Reverend Misick.
Good to see all of you. Hello.
Thank you.
Reverend, you'll use your SWIS. I like SWIS. We'll use
yeah. It. I was playing around with that last night. And I said, let me make this up here.
We'll give you credit.
We use acronyms for everything now.
Yeah, well, good.
Spiritual immunity. Weakened spiritual immune system.
Spiritual weakened immune system.
I have to go back to my notes, but yeah.
That's a great acronym. I like it too. Yes,
it is.
Jeannie.
It is.
Right.
Yeah. We need some vitamins.
I got something right in the middle. Like what is it?
Hi, Betty.
Hello. Say hello to my wife before I sign off here.
Hey, Jennifer.
Hi, Jennifer. Take care, Jennifer.
We're both zoomed out, and I'm teaching a course. She's still waiting on one. So I'm teaching a master's in psychology course, and we're doing Zoom, but they're having us train in Blackboard, and it's so sunny. Sunny's doing the same thing. It is a mess. It's draining. Yeah. But, you know, you got to do what you got to do in this day and age, and you never know.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Am I unmuted?
Hey. I am unmuted.
You're not even. We can hear you. Hi,
Ed. Hi,
Juan Carlos. Hi, Karen Del Greco.
Hi, Juan. Hi. Thank you.
Frances.
Hi, Yang.
Hi, Frances.
I'm muted.
The audio
for hi, Amuta.
Hi, Glenda. You're not muted, Betty. I hear you.
Everybody hears you, Daddy.
All right.
Everybody hears you talking about yourself.
I don't know when I'm muted or unmuted.
Yay, Daddy. We can hear you.
Hello.
Hey,
Jenny.
Hi, Janet.
Hey, everybody.
Hi, Loretta.
Hi, Loretta.
How are you?
Hi, Betty. I'm going to get off here.
You better, Daddy.
What am I saying?
Hi, Connie.
Hello. Hi, Aggie.
Hi,
Jenny.
Goodbye. You can hear everything you're saying. I can hear you
have
talking
a great
to yourself.
Week, everyone.
You good care.
Care.
Church committee. Diane.
Hey, Diane.
Hi, Diane.
Hi, guys. Hi, everyone. Goodbye. Hi, Yang.
Hi, everybody.
I can't
get hi, Sunny. News about your folks.
Hi, Sunny.
Oh, I know.
Aaron, call me.
Okay.
I can't hear you.
Oh, hello. How are you?
Okay.
My good. Zoom excellent. Is going thank in and goodness. Out, so I'm going to say goodbye.
Betty, we hear you talking to yourself.
I wanted to ask you. I wanted to ask Sonny where his parents are moving in Queens.
They're going to be your neighbors. They're moving to Talbot.
Oh my gosh, Talbot yes. Street.
Talbot
wow.
They are very close to us.
Right
I'm looking at that yeah. building too. If it's 83 something Talbot, it's called Talbot Arms or something.
I forget which one. It's the more modern looking one with a nice roof. Everything looks modern.
Great.
But,
I think I know. Okay, that's so exciting.
Yeah, it's just far enough away so that we have our own neighborhood, but it's 1 mile away from us. So.
And they've got the movie theater if that ever opens up.
Right. Yeah, and the health food store and everything.
Yeah, everything.
Yeah. So yeah, that's the big news.
That's great news.
Yeah.
Okay. Congratulations.
They might come over and borrow some sugar sometime.
That's fine. Anytime. Right. Okay. Goodbye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.
Have a great week.
Yep.
You too.
Everybody stay well and safe and God bless.
Thanks, Karen.
You too. Thank you.
Thanks, Karen. Hi, Ernie and Alice.
Hello.
Hi, Wanda. Love you all. Oh, there's Barbara and Connie. Connie, hi, guys.
Oh, you see me?
I saw Barbara for an instant. Yeah, she looks great.
Good.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Yang.
Hi, Yang.
Hi, honey.
Hi, Ernie.
Hi.